Archaeology from the University of Trieste. While in academia, Massimiliano founded the Boston University Neuroformics Lab and worked with DARPA and NASA to develop artificial intelligence networks that could learn in real time, even in computationally constrained hardware. He then transitioned this research to industry, where he founded Neurala. Today, Massimiliano will give us a glimpse into the past, the present, and future of AI, and how it can benefit humankind, as well as how it will positively affect our human activities. Massimiliano will probably spend about 35 minutes giving his presentation, and after that, we'll have a Q&A session, which I will try to moderate. I will maybe ask the participants if they want to ask questions, they can type it in the chat, and I will moderate the questions, or otherwise they can raise the hand. There is a button to raise your hand to the right of the screen, and they will be able to ask the questions in person. Before we jump into the presentation, our counsel, I want to welcome the participants and say a few words before we begin. So, counsel, I'll leave you the microphone to you.
Grazie Matteo. And thank you all for joining us this evening. It will be for sure a very interesting event. I think that AI is one of the, if not the topic that everyone is discussing today to see what the future will bring and how far will we be able to go with artificial intelligence. Will it substitute human beings? Are there moral issues involved? I'm sure that there will be many questions asked at the end of Massimiliano's presentation. We're very excited to join in with this event. It's part of the celebrations of the 60th anniversary of relations between Italy and the US. And this event is included in the events dedicated to research because Italy, as many of you of course know, is a very important country for research. And especially, I think that here in Boston, we do have many examples of very talented Italians, such as Massimiliano, that do show off the cutting edge technology and innovation that we are so very proud of. So thank you very much for joining us tonight. And I give the floor to Massimiliano Versace of Neurala. Thank you.
Bye, Matteo. Thank you. Ciao, Federica. Thank you, Federica. And thank you, Matteo. Let me share the screen. It's a pleasure to speak with you. I find it strange to speak in English to Italians, but so be it. All right, can everybody see the screen?
Yes, we can.
Awesome. So artificial intelligence, friend or foe? I hope it's not the foe, but let's see. So when everybody thinks about artificial intelligence and robotics and advanced technology, usually these are the images that come to mind or come to YouTube, right? So if you go on YouTube and type robotics AI, you see, you know, this Atlas robot from Boston Dynamics, which is a Boston company, you know, walking like a human. And if you're more adventurous, you can see a dinosaur robot, kangaroo robot, you know, snake robots, and all sorts of scary biomorphic animals that in theory will inspire you to think that, you know, a replica of human body and human or animal bodies and animal minds is, you know, coming taking over and the biology will be wiped out. In reality, the picture of artificial intelligence is very different and in a sense, much more boring, right? So, you know, this is just a snapshot of a section of the global economy that will be impacted by artificial intelligence. This is just one of the many studies and many estimates. In this case, somebody rolled the dice and find out, you know, 120 billion market for AI by 2025. I think all these estimates are, you know, underestimating in reality the impact of artificial intelligence in our world. But you can see the impact goes from agriculture to auto, you know, self-driving cars and the like. Government, retail, finance, legal, and there is no sector of the economy that is not going to be touched by artificial intelligence, because essentially wherever there is a software, you can inject better software, hence artificial intelligence software. So as opposed to program things as you were programming before, you can sprinkle a little bit of the human mind in the process that you're working on in the software and make it smarter. So AI, essentially, the concept of AI software are going to conflate and, you know, you will not talk about AI, you know, anymore in a few years, because it would be coincidental with the concept of software. And so many of these companies started in the last few years. This is me in 2014. I was in Washington giving a TEDx talk. So in 2013, we entered the Techstar company, and you can see a very similar video. I had less of this humanoid robot or self-driving robot in the background, but essentially there is much more of those today. But we were one of those, that company that essentially in 2013, we were, you know, looking for a path in deploying this very complex and futuristic technology in a commercial application. So where do we come from? Where does Neurala come from? Neurala comes from, as was mentioned by Matteo, from academia. I was a professor at Boston University. I came from Italy to pursue my PhD. And what I did is this, essentially, as I studied the brain and I, with many colleagues, we wrote equations to describe the functioning of, you know, roughly the 100 billion neurons and 250 trillion synapses that make up our brain. And our intent as scientists was to just understand us better, right? So we were curious on how you can take fairly simple ingredients like neurons and synapses and connect them together and all of a sudden develop the huge repertoire of intelligent behavior from you know, perception to planning to motor behavior that makes up you know, what is an intelligent animal or intelligent human. And we ended up through some you know, various projects to get a little bit more applied than we thought. So we didn't stop building these conceptual models and publish paper, but we were dragged into practical research. And the reason was that our technology was actually solving a tangible problem. And you might have you know, followed the recent launch of the latest Mars robot in Mars. You know, NASA was one of the agencies that sponsored our research, because they thought that eventually, the next wave of robotic probes that will you know, go to Mars and beyond, and to try to understand the makeup of our world, are going to have to be autonomous. And for instance, the helicopter that took off in Mars a few days ago was in fact autonomous. And the reason is that you cannot rely on the speed of light to communicate minute commands from the human to the robot to control its flight path, for instance. But you have to have that intelligence on board. And that's exactly what we did for NASA. We designed an artificial brain based on our study and our technology that will enable the robot to work completely autonomously, including the learning aspect, which was the essential and revolutionary things that we did for NASA, which is not only build an AI on Earth and send it to Mars, but enable this robot to continuously learn as it was exploring Mars. So essentially give it a brain that was as plastic as the, you know, human or an animal brain. And let's step back for a second. Artificial intelligence as we know it today has not been really, you know, like that before, right? There is a sort of a date where the AI revolution has restarted or has boomed. And that's around 2012, right before we came out of academia, and you know, we thought that the time was ripe to do so. Before 2012, we were working in exactly the same things. We were doing precisely the same sort of algorithm and math. But people were asking, you know, we like you, we think you're cute, but please take away all these neural networks, which is the technology that, you know, is underlying this new wave of artificial intelligence. They would think, well, don't talk about these neural networks because they don't really work. And past 2012, all these neural networks now called deep learning and whatever, it's the new wave of AI, people want only that, right? So the fashion has changed, like, you know, like if it's a Versace design, pink is the fashion, and now, you know, this new wave of deep learning is older age. And, you know, we're just riding this wave that we've been working on for, you know, 20 plus years. But the AI that's been around for many, many decades, and you surely have heard of AI before, and it's not a new technology. Now, I'd like you to divide your concept of AI in two and split it in what we call the traditional good old-fashioned AI or GoFi, which was the dominant paradigm before 2012. And you know, this technology has been deployed in many applications, but not as many as this new wave of AI. And it's a very simple concept and very simple technology. So imagine that with traditional AI or GoFi, you had to distinguish between an apple and an orange. So you will train your system by explicitly building rules such as, is the thing that you're looking at is a fruit? Yes, no. If it's a fruit, is the shape round or not? If it's a yes, then you keep going down the tree. Is the color green? Therefore, you will get, you know, probably in the category of apples. So that was the way to program artificial intelligence before 2012. The way that I've always done and always study is the neural network way, which is essentially you put all your intelligence in designing a system, and this is a caricature of this neural network or deep learning algorithms. And then the intelligence of the system relies on the data, right? So you present examples of apple and oranges, and your system gradually builds the difference between an apple and oranges based on the data, not based on explicit rule that you program, right? And intuitively, we know that this is the way the human brain works. And that's an example of two human brains. I think Federica might, you know, recognize these people. So these are Versace number 3 and number 4. So I have 4 kids. These are the latest redhead addition to my house. And so on the right, there is Aria. And on the left, there is Leonardo. And so if you guys have kids, you surely would like to do this to them and program them explicitly. Say, for instance, when mama says, pick up your stuff, please do so. But that's not how kids work, right? So they have a perception action cycle. They learn from data. They learn autonomously. And the parent or any educator is just another input in the environment. So we know that the human brain works really, really closely to deep learning algorithms, much more closely to deep learning and neural networks than to traditional artificial intelligence or GoFi. And because of that, because of the ability to imitate very closely the physiology and the anatomy of the human brain, today and after 2012, essentially every competition that has to do with artificial intelligence has been conquered by deep learning. Here I just give some example. Object recognition is one, written language recognition, spoken language, if you're using Google Translate and all the other translation, those are based in, on a neural network and deep learning. Traffic signs, in this case, in many of these cases, the AI has already developed a superhuman ability to perform these tasks, which is basically beating humans at those very, very tasks. Medical imaging. One of my PhD colleagues, he was an ex-doctor, and he used to tell me all the time, somebody will be last in medical school, to symbolize the fact that not all the doctors that you meet are gonna be extremely smart. Some of them will be stupid and will misdiagnose you. And so medical imaging is another example where AI is reaching or has already reached human or superhuman ability to do detection and the sort of medical screening that before was the province only of human perception. So this is about sci-fi and research. What about real applications? And let me give you a flavor of what is the typical path between a dream and an implementation reality of very complex technology. So this is a snapshot from DARPA. DARPA is one of the agencies that funded my work at Boston University. Is the Defense Advanced Research Agency of the United States DOD. They funded a project called Synapse, which was nonetheless copied the human brain on a piece of hardware that was the size of a shoebox in terms of real size and power consumption, and would encapsulate roughly the compute power of the human brain. So there were two teams. One was doing the hardware, and the Hewlett Packard was in charge of that. And my lab was working on the algorithms. And the idea was to copy the brain from synapses to neurons to network of neurons to large scale organization of neurons, and getting closer to imitate a processor that would be able to mimic more closely than traditional processor that we have today running, for instance, on the computer that you're watching me. The human brain. And fast forward about 12 years from those projects, many of you who bought a cell phone in the past year and a half have in their cell phone a neuromorphic processor. And a neuromorphic processor is nothing less than a coprocessor, like you have a CPU in your phone. You also have an NPU, which stands for Neural Processing Unit, which emulates a little closer than the CPU, the architecture and the functioning of the brain, and enables this algorithm to run on a cell phone, considering that you have limited battery life and limited computing capability on your phone. So it's essentially a very small piece of architecture that mimics your cerebral cortex running today on your phone. And that's one of our applications that we did in the past few years, right? So we actually deployed in many tens of millions of phones a piece of our technology in a smartphone manufacturer, a top three, you know, smartphone manufacturer in, that was designing essentially this artificial intelligence, where the user will take pictures and the AI was inside the camera application and essentially understands the image, segment the image, and understand, for instance, in this case, what each pixel represented, whether it was a person, a tree, food, or, you know, landscape, water, sky, etc., and use that information to make the picture stunning, pretty much like a professional photographer would do. But of course, there was no professional photographer in the phone. There was a piece of AI that would run in, you know, 100 milliseconds after the picture. So that's a practical application. Another practical application is in robotics, right? And so if you guys go shopping, which many of you have stopped and in the pandemic, but if you go to a Stop and Shop, which is one of the chains that you find in the Boston area, you might bump into Marty the robot, which is this often defined as scary robot. You know, it's basically like a moving column. And it's a robot that does several tasks in the grocery stores, one of which is to detect, for instance, if something spilled on the floor. And so our AI constantly monitors whether something has spilled on the floor and alerts the personnel before somebody steps on it and falls. As you know, in the United States, the first two sports are football, baseball, and then the third one is suing people. And so if you don't clean up the floor of a shop before somebody slips on it, you get sued. And so that's a multi-billion dollar industry for the retail business that they want to avoid. And essentially the robot enables them to spot instantaneously a spill within a few minutes and clear it up before somebody falls and they eventually get sued. And another application that I like to cherry pick for you is inspection, right? In this case, you're not inspecting a store, but you're inspecting an infrastructure. And so these are all jobs that are very dangerous, very, very costly. People might die falling from a wind turbine to inspect it. And so the idea is to equip drones with the ability to go up in the sky and do an inspection and understand whether a structure is safe or needs a repair, and only at that point send out a human only when it's necessary. And here, let's stop for a second, right? I talk about drones, I talk about robots, and who of you, like myself, have watched in abundance Hollywood movies, will stop and say, okay, we are done. We are completely screwed. AI is gonna take over the world. This guy's crazy. We're all going to die, right? And so this has happened in many times in our history, right? So we've been scared of things. And the first time that the humankind was exterminated, as you remember, was 1,000 years after Christ, right? So mille non più mille, right? So for some reason, somebody thought that the Bible had a sign that, you know, after 1,000 years after Christ, we're all going to die and be wiped away. So we obviously all die in the Middle Ages. And another time where we all died was in the 60s, right? So I don't know if you've seen the show called Mad Men, which is a fantastic show that, it spans between the 50s and the 70s in the United States, in the advertising business. At a certain point in the show, in the 60s, around 69, I think, they introduced the computer, right? And so you see this big fridge-like thing, this IBM frame that comes into the, you know, into the office, right? Because they use it for graphic and, you know, other tasks. And so one of the guys in their office gets crazy, and you know, he believes that the computer will take over the world and take over their jobs, and they will be all out of jobs, and that the computer will become sentient and kill them all, right? And so, you know, that didn't pan out either. But then you must remember the year 2000, right? When we all died again, because eventually we thought the computers, you know, wouldn't understand how to transition from the, you know, 1999, 31st December to 2000, you know, and all the computer system of the world will go astray. And, you know, that was the end. But this is my favorite. We all died again in 2012. And in 2012, this is particularly dear to me because December 21st, 2012 was my 40th birthday, right? So I'm born on December 21st. And so my sister-in-law, which is a little impressionable, thought I was the Antichrist. And because I was working with DARPA, I was you know, doing robotic AI. And a few days before, you know, a few months before my birthday, there was a documentary that did on our work at the university, where the last frame of the movie was in a nuclear explosion with me after the frame after writing an equation on the board. And so the documentary suggested that because of AI, we'll all die. And so my sister thought, you know, to 2012 was the date, and that was the Antichrist. I had to wait until the 1st of January of 2013 to talk to her again. And now we're cool, okay? So that's about the fear of AI and Armageddon. So we know that you know, we have this tendency to fear artificial intelligence. We've been watching too many movies about it, but we've learned that we survive as a species. So now let's go back to reality, right? So what do we do with this AI? So we know that many billions of devices are coming online constantly, right? So, you know, smartwatches, cameras, cars, and you name it. So we'll be drowning in devices by 2025. And we know the companies are looking into artificial intelligence, right? Like, say, half of the companies are estimated that their applications are going to be powered by AI. At the same time, 91% of these enterprises don't really know exactly how AI would work. And so there is a lot of uncertainty. And among, you know, all this landscape, there is Neurala. And you know, we're trying to figure out, okay, we are an expert in AI. What is our personal journey? How do we, you know, look at ways to apply artificial intelligence in a good way, you know, to help solve important problems that humankind has among this sea of possibilities, right? And, you know, we came from a past of deep learning and research. And, you know, we found a path in a fairly nonlinear way, right? So, you know, we know that all the path led to Rome. Where did Neurala's path led to? Knowing that we started in, you know, doing project in many different aspects, because the technology is really horizontal, right? It can be applied to self-driving cars, to drones, to cell phones, to cameras, you name it. And we have done all of those applications. And so what we have done in around 2018 is we have taken a step that was actually very functional to us figuring out exactly what Neurala focus would be in the next few years, which was to release a platform that you see here in its 2018 format, which was essentially a way for anybody to, you know, that has a skill in just using a normal you know, web browser to annotate some images in a video and create an artificial intelligence model that will recognize X, where X can be, I don't know, a dancer, a car, an elephant, or something more specific, like a piece of production in a factory, in a factory setting. And so remember, we came from robotics, where we were designing artificial brain to power autonomous machine. And we ended up here very strangely, but now, you know, obviously, looking at the past, that was kind of an obvious you know, target for our technology. And so what is the analogy between an advanced robot and you know, a machine, for instance, in an industrial setting, like an industrial machine? In this case, I'm actually showing an Italian machine made in Bologna. It's a packaging machine that does, I think this does pharmaceutical blisters, but the technology is widely applicable, and I'll tell you in a second where we end up with it. But a robot has a bunch of sensors, has cameras, has detectors, has antennas, has chemistry labs, has a plethora of different sensors. And the same is true for an industrial machine, minus the wheels, right? So these machines, they stay put, but they work tirelessly 24/7 for a year with a week of maintenance, doing always the same thing, for instance, you know, packaging, you know, coffee or packaging medicine, and have a very similar suite of sensors. So they have camera, they have force sensor, pressure sensor. So they're very similar to the robot that we dealt with working with NASA. And so we looked more closely at the sector of the manufacturing sector and the industrial sector as a whole. As you know, it's a huge sector. And we noticed that that this sector is also going through a revolution with a huge adoption of artificial intelligence coming its way, with the deep learning technology or this new AI technology playing a pivotal role in shaping it. And the technology was very similar to what we were designing. So a technology that can go into the factory itself in on-premise, as it's said, on a very small compute device that you can put, for instance, in an industrial machine. So we look more closely, and also another event happened, which was functional to us getting more closely tied with this sector, which was the pandemic. So, and here is interesting as, the dialogue around the robotic and artificial intelligence took a dramatic turn on our favor this time in the pandemic. So people were saying, February 2020, robots will take over manufacturing. AI is making us lose jobs. We are doomed. And in March 2020, when we had to shut down, they were nowhere to be found, right? There was not enough automation to get factories going. And people realized that they were afraid of the wrong thing. They shouldn't have been afraid of automation and AI, but they should have been afraid of not having automation, not having AI, or not having a plan. And so this created a huge urgency on top of an urgency that was already there. I don't know if you can name a person or think of a person in your circle of friends who comes to you and say, I really want to go in work in a factory. I'm gonna study at the university to become a worker in a factory. Nobody wants to do that. And so there was already a huge issue in the sector of people not wanting to go and work in factories. So the two problems compounded, which basically unleashed our decision to go forward and look more closely into this sector. And so just to give an example, manufacturing is an activity that involves many, many different steps. And there isn't one single step that we can look at more, in more details, which is the issue of quality control, right? So once you build a product or from the raw material all the way to the product when it's manufactured, you have to check its quality and eventually discard or fix things before it's too late. And so just that task absorbs roughly 35 million people worldwide, which is the population of Canada. So the population of Canada today does only that, which is to look at something when it's manufactured. And the bad news is that that's only a tiny fraction of the things that should be looked at, right? So we are very limited by the amount of humans, a decreasing amount of humans that are interested in doing this job. And we are only looking at a very small aspect of what is happening during the production. And so we decided to take the platform that I showed you that was doing elephants, zebras, and cars, and verticalize it for the idea of building an artificial brain very quickly in seconds using our technology that could be deployed in the production line. Whenever you need an eye to look at something, you can use our technology to build, deploy, and maintain an artificial intelligence eye that can detect essentially anything that you want, from the quality of a coffee capsule to the quality of an integrated circuit to essentially anything that a human eye can be trained to do. And you can do that with a fraction of the time and the cost that it will take to use an alternative system or humans. And so this can be done really in every single aspect of the production. And we have implemented things in intake of raw materials to the product, to the packaging, to the palletization and shipping, all the way to the logistic aspect when the product leaves the factory and goes to shipping. And so this is just an example of a small fraction of the application where we are working on, and that we have partnership. I had to take away the names of many of our customers, which are confidential. You can see a couple of Italians, IMA and Antares. One is in Bologna. It's one of the world leaders in packaging machines. And Antares is in Bergamo. It's one of the world leaders in track and trace solution for pharmaceuticals. And we have many more other customers, some of them in Europe, that are already using our technology or partners. So an example of this is FLIR. FLIR is one of the world leaders in cameras. They design cameras for a large number of uses, from the defense all the way to manufacturing. They are famous for their thermal cameras, so they're able to see in the infrared spectrum. And so that's one of the companies we announced about 2 weeks ago that is distributing our technology with their cameras. And why is this important? Why I'm showing it to you? Because a FLIR camera costs, I think, $200 to $300. So with our technology, for a few hundred dollars, you can essentially create a human brain equivalent that you can put on the production line at the cost where it was previously impossible. And so what does that do to you? It enables to build better products. It enables to run factories with less humans that anyway you couldn't find and couldn't hire. And possibly enables companies to build manufacturing in places where currently it's impossible, which is like, for instance, United States or Italy, where they tend to move their factories to the Far East or to East Europe, because workers are too costly. And so now they can hire less workers, more qualified workers. They will oversee artificial intelligence power system and keep manufacturing in the countries where things are consumed, and eventually create jobs rather than take away jobs in Italy, in United States, and so forth. So we are excited, but the exciting thing is that this technology can be used also beyond robotics. And so that's an example, again, with IMA in the coffee capsule machine. So if you guys use Nespresso, Lavazza, and these single dose machines that where you insert the coffee capsule and you close and press a button and magically you get a nice tasting espresso. IMA builds machines that do these kind of jobs for their customers. And our technology is actually now in these machines. We are piloting it, so it's not yet available to customers. But what happens is that these machines actually break. They derail. After a certain point, they start to make mistakes. And so they have to throw away batches of coffee, which to me, as a coffee lover, is very sad. And so what we did is we put our technology in the machines and learn it, right? So the operator basically say, learn. The machine goes on for a few cycles. Say it makes 100 or 1,000 capsules. Learn what good is. Learns what a good run is. And then is able to detect when the machine is starting to derail based on the sensor input. So the sensors start to give a little tiny, pressure, temperature, and the machine is able to do that. And the tests that we ran with IMA were very nice because the machine was able to, our AI was able to catch a defect before the human eye or the camera could catch it. And so it's sort of like, if you close your eyes and you feel your body, you kind of know something is wrong even before looking at the mirror. And so that our AI does exactly the same. So it gives the machine a sixth sense to be able to understand when it's actually going in the wrong direction. So to me, this is fantastic. It's a dream that is coming true. The idea of having machines that are stupid that surrounds us is to me is nonsensical. So that the machine have to be powered by AI to become more intelligent, more independent from human, right? So you don't want the human to spend its precious time and brain to man a machine. You want the machine to understand what to do by itself. And so what is a power, what is a future powered by AI going to look like? I don't know, but we'll see. This is what I think is going to look like in general. We'll have less of these dull jobs, which are repetitive and easily automated, non-scalable, like for instance, having a guy looking at cameras to find if there is an intruder. that's probably not going to happen. There would be somebody looking at the output of an AI system to understand if you know, there is a security breach, for instance. Less repetitive jobs. The more repetitive task would be the easiest to substitute with you know, dexterous robots or artificial intelligence. Dirty jobs, dangerous, for instance, the case of the drone inspecting unappealing jobs, you know, people rather drive an Uber than work in mud. And so now that there is this choice, somebody has to work in mud, and perhaps a robot can do that. And there will be more of this, right? So there will be more, you know, humans working a lot alongside machines, the so-called idea of cobot or co-robot, that is an automated system of which you're seeing more and more in the manufacturing, logistics, and other domains where a robot is coupled with a human to perform a task. Technology like ours, you know, with FLIR or other cameras looking at the production line and looking at quality of things, and essentially more and more of this stuff. And this is not the first or last time when a technology will replace or augment things. And it's funny because, you know, there is a dialogue around artificial intelligence, but it's easy for us to just look back and what happened in the past, you know, 100 years and say, well, you know, now AI is going to change a job to become from A to B. What about other innovation? What about the tractor? Would you ask a farmer to go back to, you know, the cow or the horse carrying the, you know, moving the plow? What about a machine? What about a typewriter? Would you ask somebody who is used to computers to go back to a typewriter? No, you like computers, right? So they're better technology. They're better suited for writing documents. And the same is for cars, right? Would you ask people to go back to the carriage and the horse? The same way, you're not going to undo artificial intelligence, right? So you're not going to ask in your right mind to somebody to give up a better software or a better process and go back to a stupid machine where you have to use your brain to do what the machine can do by itself. And the same thing is going to happen to AI. So this is a non-reversible process, in my opinion, but for the good, right? We're going to have human brain and human creativity liberated to do tasks that are in need of our intelligence versus repetitive tasks that can be easily automated. But essentially, there is also another aspect which is very dear to me. I didn't get into artificial intelligence for the sake of building a company. Actually, you know, I went into academia first, and then moved into AI into Neurala because I ended up building practical application. And the reason I did that was that, for me, my opinion, in order to better understand the brain, which was my target, right? The best way to do that was to build it. And to have a, you know, to talk about something is one thing, but to really understand it, you have to build it, right? So because in that case, you really understand what each single piece is for, rather than studying something from the external perspective. Imagine, for instance, you know, if you had to study a car without being able to build it, you wouldn't know which each piece does. But once you put it together, you understand if you don't have a brake, which actually happened when the first car, they forgot to put brakes. You know, once they build it, they understand, oops, we need the brake. And the same thing happens when you build an artificial brain. So you understand it much more closely. In doing so, we ended up stumbling on practical application. But really, I believe that the study of artificial intelligence, as a species, we look at the stars and, you know, think about colonizing Mars and beyond, we need also to look inward and understand us, understand what we are made of, and eventually how we think. And artificial intelligence is a very noble science that has cousins in neuroscience, in psychology, and many other disciplines that deserves the respect that it deserves, which is essentially in premise an intellectual endeavor that has practical applications and practical implications. So AI is a good thing. AI is a science, and the applications are really up to humans. And we can make the best out of it or the worst out of that, but that's not AI. It's really the human nature. So I hope you're going to look at AI as a, you know, in a good light. And thank you, everybody. I happy to take questions and have a discussion.
Thank you, Massimiliano. It was lovely. A very nice presentation. I saw a question coming in. Maybe I can just give folks time. As I said, you can type your question in the chat and we'll essentially try to answer them in the 15 minutes that we have. Maybe while the audience tried to, you know, internalize what you described, I can start off with a couple of questions that I had prepared. Like you showed us that the jobs of the future will drastically change from repetitive, being in the mud, to essentially being smarter jobs that require us to apply our creativity and other, you know, more deeply evolved functions. Do you think that the education systems in the United States, in Italy, to some extent, are aligned to essentially create this new generation of people that will have to work with AI? And if they are not, what do you think are the biggest gap? Like what should they focus on to get them prepared?
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great question. So my favorite job is become an AI scientist. So as you know, AI is really in its infancy. So and every technological innovation, like even if you're thinking, for instance, to the Industrial Revolution, has taken away huge number of jobs, huge numbers, right? So before, you know, just the textile industry needed, you know, 100 employees, and now you needed one. Earth has expanded from, you know, a billion to, you know, how many are we? 5, 6, 7 billions. And many of us have jobs still, including in countries where there is manufacturing. Right, so those jobs have changed, and we don't know exactly how AI will change the nature of jobs. But as for instance, if you're looking back at the Industrial Revolution, we didn't need 100 people to sew things and to make t-shirts, but now we have a sprawling industrial manufacturing industry that build machine to build those things. Right, so for instance, the very tiny insignificant sector that today is robotics and artificial intelligence will balloon to a huge, gigantic sector where, you know, millions and millions of people will be employed to build, manage, create laws for, regulate, administer, you know, artificial intelligence, robotic and automation. And so that's a huge sector. For instance, you know, the tiny sector of laws around artificial intelligence, it's completely unexplored, or ethics around AI. There is a seed of that, but there are incredible opportunities and a very large number of jobs that will be related to this new ecosystem that will come up, and most likely they will absorb very, very large swath of humanity. My favorite is obviously engineering, software, and AI, neuroscience. So what you see today are a caricature of the human brain. We don't know anything about the brain, if you're asking me. You know, we know just enough to replicate something really trivial, but the whole workforce related to artificial intelligence design or robotic, those are huge opportunities that have very, very good jobs for our kids to start to pursue.
Interesting. And
I wouldn't go into driving a cab school. Okay. That's for sure.
Yeah, like I was thinking, some of the examples, like Germany is thought to be like a good country where they're trying to get kids to go into technical schools so to get them prepared for the new jobs in the manufacturing world. And it, what you described today kind of aligns with that, with the vision they have in the country. I've seen a lot of questions coming in. Before we jump into those, I just had mine that relates to the first one. You have children, like you showed us a couple of pictures, like, and there are many parents today with us. Like, how do you approach this? Like, how are you thinking about making sure that you can somehow accompany your children into understanding their role into the world in the future? Because most of the jobs they will probably end up being into, they don't exist today, like you said. So how are you approaching this problem as a parent? Does it stress you, or I don't know? That's my final question, I guess.
It's funny because, you know, you're asking probably the, you know, a very unique person, right? Because our kids, you know, we had, me and my wife actually run Neurala, the company, right? So I'm married with the co-founder of the company. So it's sort of a family business. And so we had the privilege and probably the not so brilliant idea to take our kids to work until the fourth came. And the fourth, we say, okay, we can't do this anymore. So we had kids for, you know, when from 0 to 2 years old, they always come to the office. So my kids were always exposed to that. And if a parent asked to our kids, what do your parents do? They always say they build robots, right? And so to them is really normal that our job are essentially to create something new from scratch. And so, you know, in my case, it just happens that, you know, it's easy. If I will be, you know, the parent of somebody that is not on a, you know, doing a day-to-day AI, you know, business, I will definitely try to expose, you know, their kids to the idea that artificial intelligence and software are going to, you know, become so useful that many of the jobs that today are available will probably not be available to them. In the way they're thinking, for instance, you know, become a translator or a cab driver, or, you know, doing, you know, some tasks that are easy, repeatable, it's probably not going to be a good career choice. And I will steer them towards sciences and the very technical disciplines where the, you know, the human mind and the creativity aspect of the human mind is important. And so, you know, those disciplines, I think, you know, that the programming side and engineering and the hard sciences, I think that's a good choice. You know, and probably practical works that are easy automated, that there would be a not so good of a choice.
Thank you. So maybe I'll jump in into a few questions that came in from the audience. I'm going to start from Lydia. Lydia was asking, are you applying Neurala's technology to any COVID-related manufacturing of vaccines?
Yes, we don't know the details, but one of our customers, which I cannot disclose, is a top 10 pharmaceutical companies that is using our inspection technology stuck to a microscope to look at compounds, chemical compounds for screening, right? And so you know that advanced manufacturing of or advanced research of chemical compounds and the pharmacological compounds, you know, you run very large number of experiments, and a few of these experiments might lead to something, right? So it's a very tough science. It's a very repetitive science, and the artificial intelligence can be used to automate the aspect of screening of hundreds of thousands of pictures of these molecules to understand which one are the more promising than others. And if you're thinking of you know, new variants of coronavirus coming up, and you know, the production of additional vaccines, and sort of the race against the, you know, the virus, I think AI plays a very important role, because, you know, you can use artificial intelligence to get to the results much quicker and in a much more targeted way. We cannot give details, but the answer is yes, we are working on something related.
Thank you. That was a very nice answer. Second question from Giovanni. A number of Teslas have crashed because the drivers were not at the wheel. Do you think that is due to faulty AI?
Possible. So just to step back, the idea of artificial intelligence and you know, what it's supposed to do, it's kind of ill-posed. The target is not God, right? God is God, and God is perfect. Amen. Humans are not, right? So as you know, people crash all the time. And so I don't know what's the percent correct of a typical human, but it's not 100%, right? So so first of all, if your target is to achieve perfection, forget it. In certain cases, we can be better than humans, right? We have talked about that in a few use cases where there is already superhuman intelligence. But the idea of artificial intelligence being unable or being so perfect that it's not going to do a mistake is wrong. What you're aiming at is to be better, as good as or better than humans. And sometimes AI is actually useful, even if it's worse than humans. For instance, there are examples where humans were, you know, in some use cases that we looked at, but they were only 60% accurate. And so our customers say, well, if you're 60% accurate, for us, it's fine, right? So there are many use cases where that's okay, right? Even a 60% accurate AI adds value, you know, saves money or creates value. So going back to Tesla, yes, there are certain use cases that have to do with AI, you know, being faulty. I remember the first accident of Tesla was the, you know, overexposure of the camera. And, you know, I was personally in a car where we got into a small accident where there was a glaring problem. So there was a light aligned with the sun, and my friend was driving the car, didn't see there was a red light because the sun was so intense that even the human eye, which has a range of a dynamic range of million fold better than a camera, was fooled. And so in certain cases, there is not going to be anything to save for an accident. You know, they just happen. Having said that, the better the AI is, the better the cars will get. And overall, in the next few years, I think we're going to get to a stage where streets will be safer because AI will be constantly alert. It won't get drunk, distracted, won't check its messages. Right, as 99.9% of the people in the car do, and I also drive a motorcycle, and I can see that they're not looking, right? Because the motorcycle driver looks at the eye of a driver to understand if it's paying attention, and they're not. They're watching their cell phone, right? You know, they're on Instagram rather than driving. So I would step back and consider what's the alternative. The alternative is potentially drunk, smoking marijuana, checking his Instagram driver or an AI. I will take the AI any day.
Thank you. Thank you, Massimiliano. We have a few questions. I hope you can stay maybe 3 or 4 minutes just to exhaust them. Okay. So we have the next one from Luisa. It's really interesting, of course. So for your AI algorithms, do you use known deep learning techniques, or do you code your own algorithms to avoid the issue of the black box, which is very familiar to the people who work in the space today?
Yeah, so that we do both, right? So you know, when we say our algorithm, we have many, right? So we have a suite of tools. Some of the tools we build ourselves, as we are AI scientists, and some others we adapt from the literature and we put them together a little bit of ours on top of other people developed networks, right? So we do both. In terms of the other part of the question was the black box nature. And that's actually a very interesting question. So a few months ago, we released a feature of our product, which is called explainability, which is a new word made up, but essentially it pertains to the feature of artificial intelligence that enables the user to understand why it took a decision that it took. And you know, there are certain applications where this is extremely important. For instance, in deciding your credit, deciding when to fire a weapon or not, deciding on a legal issue, right? So you have to be able to articulate why AI took the decision that it took. And so that's a new, you know, speaking of new jobs, Matteo, that's a new job, right? So the understanding the AI, the reason why an AI does what it does. One thing that is important to understand is, again, the human limitation, right? So if I ask Matteo, why do you like lasagna? I don't know if you like lasagna, but I assume you do. Yeah, I mean, you can made up your reason, but you know, we all know that our own mind is certain, you know, in a certain aspect inaccessible, right? Why did you marry the person you married, right? You make up stories and you know, you kind of rationalize with language, but there is, you know, Freud introduced the concept of well, he was one of the best in explaining the concept of a subconscious, right? Which is essentially, well, something lies underneath your consciousness, and so you cannot access. You don't know many things about your brain. Actually, you know very very tiny percentage of the reason why you do what you do. With AI, actually, we have a privilege because we designed the system from the ground up. We know each neuron by first and last name. we can do things that we cannot do to humans. So I cannot open your skull, probe your neurons and understand what's going on, but I can do that with artificial intelligence. And so I can paradoxically have a much better understanding of AI and its decision than you can have understanding of how human mind takes its decision. So it's a science that is maturing, but my forecast is that we will be able to trace decision in AI much better than we can trace decision in humans pretty soon.
Interesting. I think that answers that question. So we have one, two, three questions left. Are you okay to go through them? Okay. So from Francesca, what is the rate of mistakes of AI-related technology? Would humans still supervise the robot's automated instruments? And I think that this relates to your discussion about the manufacturing jobs.
Yeah, so it depends. There are certain tasks where AI and robotics cannot be applied, and those paradoxically seems to be the easiest task for humans, right? Right. So manipulate an object, which to us comes extremely natural. You remember the video with my kids doing this on the, you know. So those are tasks that involve learning the dexterity, coordinating between eye and arm, and essentially learning how a movement relates to a perception on how a perception can relate to a movement. And so those are really complex tasks that we learn by doing. And so robotics up to today has been really, in the GoFi, good old fashioned AI mindset, mostly like trying to force program these tasks. AI is, trying to introduce more of this learning paradigm, but today in some of the tasks, AI is really not really, performing well. There are other tasks where we are applied, for instance, where our precision rate goes in, between the 90 to 100%. And so those tend to be the situation where the environment is fairly well controlled. So there is not like a ton of stuff that is weird going on. And that tends to be the reality in manufacturing in many cases, right? So in many of these situations, it's a very standardized process that repeats. And so in those particular use cases, as we wait for AI to become more robust in the next decade or so, there are already a certain number of applications where the environment is constrained enough that we can get accuracy comparable to a human. And so we can start to take over some of those jobs or add AI. That's another important concept. Add AI where before there was nothing, right? So one of the use cases that we are working on with a Fortune 10 companies in the food, pet food manufacturing. And so if you have a pet, you have one of those canned food and you open it up, sometimes they find plastic and foreign objects, and they want to pinpoint those objects before they get packaged in the can. And so that's basically looking at raw material that goes into, a conveyor belt, which is meat and all sorts of things. And so our AI can be put there where before they had no human doing the job, right? So in those cases, we perform well enough because what we're doing right now, even if you are 90% correct, it means that you are improving from zero and you're adding, some sort of quality control that then decreases the product recall or the product, the issues the customers say, oh, I found a human eye in my dog food, I'm going to sue you, right? So now with our AI, you can prevent those until you get to 100% in the next few releases where you basically prevent these problems altogether.
Thank you, Massimiliano. We have the last two from Giovanni again. Are we at progress point where emotions can be inserted into AI?
Interesting. So when we were in the past, when we were, in our academic lab, we designed a system called Moneta, which stands for Mobile Neural Agents. I forgot. It was, 15 years ago, which was essentially an emulation of a rat brain to navigate around an uncharted environment, because rats are really good doing that. If you have one at home or had the chance to have a mouse, you know that they're really good at that. In that case, we had to insert a couple of emotions in the mouse because otherwise it wouldn't work. And the first emotion that we needed to, or I don't know if I can call it emotion or non-rational things, was curiosity, right? So if we realized that if the mouse didn't have curiosity, it wouldn't move, it wouldn't explore, And actually my research, you know, with my PhD advisor had many, many papers around cognitive emotional interaction, right? And so emotions are actually a standard tool that you need for brain to function and to select, for instance, among many, many different things that you can do, right? If you have imagine that you have 100 billion neurons in your brain, and you know, these neurons produce goals and tasks that you want to do. How do you distinguish between them? How do you weight one with respect to the other? And so you tend to attach emotions and priorities and the values to those actions, and which can be negative or positive values. And you also use emotion to override current behaviors. So for instance, you know, I when I go back to Italy, I go running in the hills. And I also do that in July when it's like 40 degrees centigrade, you know, and to risking a syncope or a syncope. And one day I was running, so I had my brain designed, executed the motor program of running up the hill. And I see a black thing, snake-wise, crossing the path in front of me. And so before I realized it, I jumped over the thing. And then, you know, that was an emotional reaction mediated by a piece of my brain called the amygdala. And the amygdala is, you know, receives connection straight from your eyes, overrides the cerebral cortex, and it is one of the centers that is pivotal in emotions in a positive and negative way. So that's the center that makes you freak out. So in that case, it saved my life. In reality, I looked back and there was not a venomous snake, but in my region, we have vipers, the so-called vipera cornuta, which if it bites you, is not fun, right? You die. And my brain used motion, freaking out to make me jump before I could realize consciously what I was jumping, that it took me 200 milliseconds to do a jump. So that's a typical example where if you want to realize AI or robotics that actually works, you have to fold in emotions in it. But I think that many of the practitioners of artificial intelligence today are new. They've skipped those pages in the handbook, and you know, maybe we'll get them a few years from now, but definitely emotion will play a role in AI.
Oh, thank you, Massimiliano. The last question from Giovanni was congratulating you for the great presentation. And I think he had one general question. How do you think the world will be in a few years? Do you foresee a big acceleration in the adoption of AI, or do you think it's still going to take 10, 15, 20 years? What do you think?
Well, I think we passed the Rubicon. No, we are on the other side. AI is not anymore a scary technology. There are so many companies working, and I think the adoption will accelerate in the next few years. So we are definitely in a spot where the number of technology powered by AI will be increasing. I think that you know, we are going to start to take seriously this technology and realize how important it is when we are going to see more physical instantiation of this technology. So for instance, I know Matteo, you work at Amazon, and you know, as you see the Kiva system, more of these Kiva robots taking over, and more, you know, robotics into the warehouses and so forth. So as more of these applications become physical, we'll perhaps realize that there's been a quantum jump. But what to us looks like an exponential, you know, things is actually fairly linear in history, right? So, you know, there is what we think is a revolution. We're going to look back 20 years from now and look at us and say, well, we're still in the Stone Ages. You know, this guy was talking about AI manufacturing, but look back where we put AI, you know, in 2040. And we're going to look at us as children and, you know, naive cavemen into this technology. So let's not lose track of that.
Yeah, and it's a good thing, I guess, that we record everything now. And in 20 years, we can look at this video and see how fucked up we were, I guess.
So remember this piece when I say that, you know, we're still children, because they're going to look and say, okay, that guy understood that, you know, he was stupid. Because that's what we are. We are really still in the dark. You know, we think we know, but we know very little.
Thank you. Well, I think we exhausted the questions. We are actually 10 minutes late. I wanted to thank you again, Massimiliano, for you know, coming here and presenting Neurala and what artificial intelligence is, and giving really us a look into the future. I want to thank again Professionisti Italiani in Philadelphia and Italians in DC for helping us organize the event, and obviously also the Consulate General of Italy in Boston for sponsoring. Consulate, do you want to say maybe last a few words before we depart?
No, I think that, as I said before, this event was amazing, and a lot of interesting questions, a lot of interesting answers. My heartfelt jealousy for the little kids that he showed earlier, because Massimiliano knows that I'm very jealous. They are so beautiful.
I can give it to you for a weekend and then you let me know.
But we can trade kids, okay? Okay. Only if we trade kids. So thank you for everyone that participated. Thank you to PIB, to all the different PIBs in the US. And thank you obviously to Massimiliano for a truly, truly astounding and interesting presentation. Hope there are more events like this and in person as soon as possible.
Thank you so much. It was a pleasure, and have a good night, and thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.